The idea of gas chromatography is to separate materials based upon their behavior as a gas. But what about this guy? This is glucose. What about this guy? This is arachidonic acid. I believe it's the C20 or the C22 carboxylic acid. It's an omega-6. What about this guy? It's a very common material in biological systems. How about these guys? These are androgens is the category, steroids, estrogen, progesterone, testosterone, all kinds of steroids. There's bazillions of them. How about this guy? This is tetrahydrocannabinol, the delta 9 metabolite, very common analyte in chemistry laboratories. So we say, well, we'll just heat them up and get them hot enough and they'll turn into a gas and we'll just, not really. You heat these guys up and heat them up and they will decompose before they'll ever turn into a gas. They just don't do gas. They are commonly analyzed by gas chromatography. Organic chemists, chromatography people look at the molecule and say, how are we going to make this fly? Like, what are we going to have to do to make this go into a gas? These molecules tend to stick together, and the way to make them go into a gas is to tie up the groups that make them stick together, which are particularly OH groups, hydroxyl groups, carboxylic acid groups, the COOH group. And the way to do it is to derivatize them so that these groups are gone, and then they become different molecules. But you can still quantitate them. The rule in analytical chemistry is you're less concerned about the specific details as much as that they are reproducible. So you run your standards and your controls and your blank and your samples all through the same procedure, and you're analyzing for something that's really not the same as what you started out with, but you can still identify and quantitate it. Let's put together a very quick example. We're going to run two samples. We need a blank, a standard. Remember, this is a 2-point calibration, but one of them is 0, 0. So we only need one standard. So blank, standard. We need a control, which is an independent standard, essentially. And then let's say we have two samples. So we have five tubes we're going to run. Get five test tubes, label the test tubes, put them in a rack, put 1 milliliter exactly of the sample in the bottom of each one. 1 milliliter exactly. This is an internal standard quantitation. So I say 1 milliliter exactly. The operative word is exactly. This is an internal standard. Add 250 microliters exactly of the internal standard. Okay, so add the internal standard, and it's not very much. Just put in a little bit of internal standard. A real common stage in extractions is to acidify the sample a little bit. So put in 50 microliters of acid, and then add a milliliter of, and let's pick ethyl ether as a solvent. So add a milliliter of ether to each one. So you've got the blank would be a milliliter of water, the standard would be a milliliter of the standard, a milliliter of the control, a milliliter of sample one, and a milliliter of sample two. So let's look very quickly at the chemistry of it. We have the sample, which is hydrophilic. It's a water-based material. The sample is typically urine or maybe blood or a biological laboratory specimen or something like that, but it's hydrophilic. The internal standard could be added dissolved in isopropanol or something like that. It really doesn't matter. The ether is, of course, hydrophobic. The ether will be on top. And then vortex the whole thing. Vortex it using a little tabletop vortexer. Just do them one at a time. It just take you a minute, maybe like 10 seconds a piece or 15 seconds a piece. Vortex them really, really good. put them back in the rack, they will perhaps quickly start to separate with the ether on top and the hydrophilic layer on the bottom. Remember, the an ordinary solvent, if it's not chlorinated, will go to the top. So the ether will be on top. A common procedure at this point is to put the tubes in a centrifuge and centrifuge them to help this separation process. Centrifuge them, it'll just take a few minutes, put them back on the rack. Now the ether is nicely separated on top. The hydrophilic layer, which is now junk, is now on the bottom. So the big picture is we want the hydrophilic layer, which is now junk, gone. We want the ether gone too, and we want the extracted material left in one of these little guys, in a little auto sampler vial. A technique would be to take the tube, take this vial, put a half a mil from the tube off the top, a half a mil into here and blow it down. Put another half a mil into here and blow it down. Put another half a mil into here and blow it down. And the ether will be gone. The hydrophilic layer will be left behind. And all the analytes will be left in the autosampler vial. So basically, just manually, it's not real simple, really. Just manually, a little bit at a time, transfer the ether layer to an autosampler vial and blow it down. Transfer a little more and blow it down. Transfer a little more and blow it down. Transfer a little more and blow it down. In actual fact, the way this would work would be you'd have the five tubes, five disposable pipettes, like Eppendorf pipettes, and five of these guys labeled. And you would be constantly cycling them into, like you'd put some in the first one, some in the second one, some in the third one, some in the fourth one, some in the fifth one, wait a few minutes, do a little bit more, wait a few minutes, do a little bit more, wait a few minutes. You'll have a block that will help you blow it down, and you'll want to warm it up just a little bit. The ether is really volatile, and it doesn't take as long as you might think to transfer the ether into one of these little vials. They use reactive vials for this. It's an autosampler vial, but it has a conical bottom. I don't think of them as being disposable, so you're going to want to probably put them in a furnace or something before you use them. And then, so now you have the ether is gone. The analytes are stuck along the side of the reactive vial. You can't see them. Take these vials. You got five of them. Put 50 microliters of your derivatizing agent in them. Vortex them. Follow the directions for the particular derivatizing agent you're using, but you're probably going to want to heat them up for a while, like 20 minutes or something like that. Vortex them. Put them in the heating block, maybe vortex them once in a while they're in the heating block. Let the reaction take place, and then without doing anything else, take these vials and put them in the autosampler. And set up a program and see what you get. This analysis involves an extraction and a transfer step. The extraction has a percent efficiency. The transfer step is a quantitation. There's a quantitation error introduced with the transfer step. It's very important to not transfer any of the hydrophilic layer. It's more important to not get any of the hydrophilic layer than it is to get all of the ether layer. So you're going to have some ether left behind. It's not going to be the same amount every time. You're using an internal standard, so you don't really need to worry too much about that. The nature of the mass spec is that the sensitivity is not going to be much of a problem, so don't worry too much about getting every tiny little bit of it. Be very careful to not get any of the hydrophilic layer, and the quantitations will come out fine if you set it up right initially. And run it through the mass spec. The GC mass spec will give retention times according to what you're looking at. It'll give ions according to what you're looking at, which aren't really the same as what you started out with, but it doesn't matter. Follow it through the same with the standards and the samples, and the standard will tell you where your retention time is, and you know, you're going to be looking it up in a reference, obviously, for what your ions will be, but your standard will confirm that, and your standard will confirm the retention time, and you can do very good quantitative work with this. So you say, well, but derivatized gas chromatography, so I want to make a guess that 30% of all gas chromatography is with a derivatized analyte. This is not an obscure branch of gas chromatography.